out every day. I'll call to order the April Finance Committee. Welcome everybody here this afternoon. We will, as usual, begin with the consent agenda. Are there any items anyone would want pulled off of consent?
C1 and
go ahead, sir.
C1 and C8.
C1 and C8. John, you had your hand up.
C5.
C5. Dan, you got any?
I move for approval.
We have a motion to approve the balance. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. Those are approved. And we will take them in the numerical order. If the secretary could read C1, please. Mr. McIntosh, I think you asked for this.
Mr. Riley, this is an area that we're spending a fair amount of money in a RUCA fund to do improvement. I was just wondering if there was any sort of update or a plan that we could see on what will be done to the outside of the building. I know that the neighbor has spent quite a bit of money upgrading his. I just didn't know what the plan was on this.
Sure.
Project.
I think we can look into that. My understanding is, well, there are facade improvements and parking lot enhancements and things that are planned, but if you'd like us to bring back more detail on what those potentially could look like.
And I'm not talking about a full-blown rendering, but just some sort of maybe sketch.
Happy to do that.
That'd be great.
Any other questions from anybody?
May I just make a
comment? Yes, ma'am. Ms. Burke.
I'm very pleased that we will bring this to us. It's something that we have needed, and I feel that what we're going to see whenever Mr. Ryan brings it back, we will see more of a structured, organized plan that will make people want to properly spend their money and do some investment.
All right. Do we have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second. We have a motion to second on C1. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise, that is approved. We will now go to C5. Mr. Larson, I believe you asked for this.
Thank you. This is a fairly simple acknowledgement, I think, of Dr. Charles Tara, who made this land available. And sometimes these things get lost in the shuffle of projects, but the availability to actually implement a parking lot on the Greenway, I think Mr. Bessie would approve of a citizen coming forward and actually making the land available as a gift to the city, and I appreciate that.
Could we be sure that somebody sends a formal thank you letter to him? Maybe the mayor could sign if he wouldn't mind. Okay, do we have a motion on C5?
Move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on C5. All in favor say aye. Oh, excuse me, Ms. Burke.
Anytime, Ms. Councilman Larson, we've always been appreciative. It's nice that you bring that out. And we have made a special comment about it. And I think, Mr. Chairman, that would be very good. Let them know we appreciate the mayor, but the mayor and council people appreciate it, especially the council person in the ward who's representing the area. And I thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. That is C5. No.
Right.
C8. Secretary will read that. Turner, this one's a little different. Why don't you give us a one minute on this one?
Certainly, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Whenever there's a utility project that goes through a neighborhood, the city assesses the pavement condition scores before and after the project. If those scores drop by 20 points, then the project is responsible for doing resurfacing of those roads, not just patching, but actual full resurfacing. That's what's occurred in this situation. There are a number of roads that have a pavement condition score that has dropped below 20 points. There are some where it hasn't dropped below 20 points but still need to be resurfaced. So we've divided the project up and are recommending resurfacing of all the roads in the area where the vast majority are being funded by the Utility Commission and the remainder are being funded by city funds.
Thank you. Mr. McIntosh.
Yeah, I guess my question, I drive through there all the time. There's no doubt that the quality of the roads are pretty bad, especially with all the work going on. But I guess $900,000 seems like a big number to not have anticipated in advance. I mean,
The patching work for the project was $1.3 million. The commission did have significant concern about having to spend another $600,000. And so we're looking at what options we might have for just rolling regular resurfacing into the cost of doing the utility project, as opposed to a process that has a two-step resurfacing where there's a patch done and then a resurfacing at the end, maybe just doing a cold patch or some preliminary resurfacing or preliminary patching and then a final resurfacing at the end. Staff is discussing that to see whether there's a better way of utilizing the funds.
I guess my concern is more about the inaccuracy of the original bids and the scope of the project.
Well, there's nothing inaccurate. It was additional work at the end of the project as a result of our policy. So it wasn't intended to be in the original scope to begin with.
But it still does seem like it's a $4 million project that we allocated $3 million for, now we're coming back with another $900,000.
Understood.
Mr. Bessie, this is... excuse me, go ahead.
Okay. I guess just for the listening public and people, when we say that the road has issues that have degraded, it would be great, Mr. Turner, if you could just say what some of those issues might be. To the regular persons, they wouldn't know what we mean when we say that this was caused by X over the course of whatever.
Certainly. The issues that the road has are or include things like subsurface failure, alligator cracking, base repairs of subsurface failure, for instance. But one of the major issues is whenever a resurfacing is done, then you'll have an uneven pavement between the existing final course and the new patch final course. And in some cases, that patch actually will settle at a different rate than the original road unless there's a overlay that's done at the end of the full project. So from the standpoint of the motoring public, what they see is a number of street cuts and patches that are uneven and make driving a challenge. From the standpoint of the adjacent property owner, what they experience is vibration and cracking of their plaster walls that creates a problem when these vehicles are traveling down the road in front of their home.
And my next question, Chair, would be, have we ever seen this much degradation in any other major street in the city or streets? Because this is like major and odd.
When we did the west end of the city several years ago, we had a lot of resurfacing that had to be done. As far as quantities, I can't say, but as far as the percentage of the project, it was comparable.
Thank you.
Mr. Bessie.
Yeah, I think in sort of just what Ms. Turner mentioned in follow-up to back up to that, I think what's different about this project is the extent of the work involved in one project. And so instead of having a relatively limited utility project that then, you know, sort of the tail end could be handled by a workover change approved at the city manager level, got an extremely large sub-basin with a lot of major streets torn up over the period of a year. And so the raw numbers, while they're not out of line with the percentage of projects and others in the past, total a sort of an eye-opening figure and way beyond what could be approved by the city manager at the special approval. We've had suggestions for future process changes to build a larger amount into the contingency to deal with the resurfacing that you anticipate you're going to have to do at the end. What's been the challenge is knowing which blocks would qualify under the 20-point degradation which would go down by like 18 and technically not get over what our standards let us charge the utilities as opposed to the street resurfacing. But if, you know, at the discretion of the council, we could change the rules going forward to specifically build that into the advance bid amount for the project.
I don't know that I want to build in because that would become an automatic, we can spend it,
yeah,
sort of dollar. So, I mean, I'd rather deal with it on a case by case. But it does seem like it's a pretty wide variance. You know, it's a 30% miss.
We're being driven on this road based on utilities work. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And the ability to forecast the amount of damage that is being done by the utilities installation process is not something that we're able to do accurately on this scope of work?
Well, the problem is you can't determine until the end of the project what the damage as a result of the project has been in terms of the pavement condition scores. So depending on what the contractor has to dig up as he gets into the project will determine how wide a cut he has to make. Depending on what the conditions are of the subsurface determines how good the patch is able to be established. Depending on how good the existing pavement will adhere to the new pavement determines how good a joint you will have. All of those are field conditions that are difficult to determine in advance.
I don't know a single patch that I've ridden over that didn't have a bump on it. And usually these patches are depressed over time and get worse through time. And the problem I'm hearing, and I don't know what the solution is forecasting on a project as big as this project has been, adequately knowing in advance, particularly with the bond repaving that we've authorized through this city, the ability to come in and when you have major disruption, forecast the complete repavement. It seems to be a matter of coordination to some degree between utilities and our streets department as to the scheduling of work and the scope of work that's going to be required. And it seems to me a little bit that maybe we didn't fully anticipate or forecast properly through communication with utilities just how much damage was to be done. And subsequently, now we're going to cover it, and we should cover it. We've got to cover it.
Utilities is covering their portion, and right. The council is being asked.
And now we have to pick up the bottom, the rest. And we didn't really know it was going to be this much. That's what I'm hearing Mr. McIntosh say. And I can sort of understand. I feel like I'm being held hostage to utilities work a little bit here in this process based on the scope of work that far exceeds what we had anticipated and having to recover.
And understood the question.
Yep.
I will say I don't know this particular job as well as I do the West End. I go to church in the West End, and I can tell you that I think lots of roads were dug up, and I think we did water and sewer then.
Correct.
And they were significant cuts. And as you say, every patch is either up or down the surface because you cannot get the same compaction of the dirt once you take it out.
And I just happen to know the same thing's going to happen on Main Street in Old Salem in about a year. Mm-hmm. And I think we better be prepared to handle that.
Okay. Mr. Larson, maybe you can manage that better than Mr. Bessie did.
Yeah.
Right. Do I have a motion on C8?
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. That is approved. That is the three items that were on consent that were pulled off. We will now go to the general agenda. And there are five items here. We'll start with item one. Mr. Borley, who's got this one? Yeah, are you going to present this? You go right ahead.
Mayor, Chairman Clark, Mayor Pro Tem Fred Burke, and members of the Finance and City Council. In October 2016, a community meeting was held to discuss the future of the Long Creek Golf Course. Later in November of last year, the city's Recreation and Parks Department and Real Estate Division met with representatives of the Conservation Fund who wanted to partner with the city and help preserve as open space the closed golf course. And the Conservation Fund offered to have the property appraised and to be involved in that possible acquisition by the city. Property was originally on the market for $4.1 million. The Conservation Fund had it appraised. It appraised at $739,450. And based on that appraisal, the Conservation Fund made an offer to the property owners. And because the property owners were civic-minded and also wanted to see some preservation take place, they accepted that offer. Conservation Fund then, in the proposal involving the city, would purchase the entire 165 acres for $739,450 later this month. And immediately at closing, the city would pay $503,000 for approximately 100 acres of the good upland area. And at that same time, the conservation fund would take title to approximately 65 acres of the floodplain land that had some historic significance to it. The conservation fund would then hold that land till sometime in 2018. They're going to apply for grants to reimburse themselves for their $236,500 investment. So in the end, the city would receive the entire 165 acres appraised at $739,450 for $503,000 through the efforts of the Conservation Fund in being involved in this project. So this is the proposal that is for you today for the purchase of the closed golf course. Also, the city staff has developed two short-term options for management of the land, and those two options could be are in your materials and could be explained further by Recreation Parks Director William Royston, if you so desire, where staff is available for any questions you might have.
Could someone comment where the money's coming from this? I know it's bond money. Could someone just comment on that?
This would be the parkland bond acquisition money from the 2014 bonds. I think there's $1 million originally allocated for parkland acquisition.
Okay, and this would take roughly half that amount.
Balance of 575
in
there.
Okay.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to ask them to give me, because I won't be voting on this today, I'll just give payments, I'll give a little more information. How much actually parkland do we actually have in this city? And where our golf course is located in this city? And of course, someone said the money is coming from the 2014.
Okay.
I don't want to be misunderstood. I'm not against the project, but there are a lot of things that I can look at. I want to make sure we do have it, and I want to be fair across the board, how where we have our parkland, where we have our golf courses and kinds of things for recreational facilities. And also, when we look, even though we say that we are not, we're concerned about the whole city, but I want to know, get broken down, what are some of the throughout this city? What are the recreational things we have? And how are they used? Because we have nice buildings, and some of them, even in my area, not even used as they should. And what is the recreational department doing, since we do have a new director, to be more progressive and ambitious in how we talk about what we have for the citizens to use? I think the uses of these facilities are most important. You can go to Carver, where we have the Russell Community Center, and the same 25 folks use it over and over. And I'm saying we need to try to get more involvement. And this comment has nothing to do with whether I'm going to support or not support this. This is information that I would like to have.
Okay. Do we have any other questions or comments?
Is Mr. Royston here? I would like to get a brief overview of what it will be when it's acquired and put in service. Not a golf course.
Good afternoon, members of the Finance Committee, Chair. I'm sorry, Councilmember, but I did not hear your question.
Just what the plan would be. How would this park function? What would be its purpose? Is it more of a walking trail kind of thing, or a frisbee golf thing, or is there a concept yet on how it will be used other than just open space?
Typically, our process would be to hire a consultant, do an RFQ to hire a qualified consultant that would engage in several community meetings where we would ask the community what they would like to see in terms of park development. There are some ideas that we would have as recreation from the city standpoint, a recreation standpoint, in terms of what we think would be very good viable recreational opportunities there, such as disc golf. We don't have a disc golf course here in the city. But we would seek to get the citizens' input in terms of what they would like to see built or developed there at the property, and then prepare a a plan to get that work accomplished, whether it's phased in or whether it's something that we do with a one-time cost.
And then one last question for you is, what are the options to connect this to our other, to our greenways? I mean, is there a path likely out of here to connect it to other assets we have?
I've met with several members of the planning department. There isn't any direct connection to an existing greenway. There are some plans long term for possibly connected to the mountain to sea trails. But what we would do, and what we did look at as a really, really good option, viable recreational opportunity there, was to have some sort of walking loop there within the park that would provide that type of opportunity for the residents in the community.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Larson.
Well, it's one heck of a buy at $503,000. But, I mean, I guess the question is, right now we're saying $100,000 to keep it mowed every year. Is that your estimate?
That is our estimate.
And then $30,000 to keep the pool open this year?
Yes.
Is that the plan? So right now we're not going to have a golf course, but we would have an active swim pool out there?
It will be, if we move forward with the purchase and council does support it, it will be our intention to open the pool this upcoming season.
Open that pool up. Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Besson.
In the North Ward, but it's in the immediate proximity part of the Northeast Ward. So familiarize myself with the area and have to agree that it's an appropriate purchase for the present Anderson part of the city.
Okay, Mr. Montgomery.
Ditto. and just one question on the fund. So there's 575 in the fund. Subtract this, there'd be 72. Is that what I'm saying? Okay, just want to make
sure. Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, I just wanted to sort of, everybody said the right things there, but thank Mike Leonard with the Conservation Fund for helping to broker this, and Councilmember Adams was involved in that as well. So roughly $3,000 for 165 acres is pretty good.
I had a couple questions. One is, are there any restrictions on either the land we buy initially or what is given to us later?
I believe the current zoning restrictions do not inhibit any us doing any type of development in terms of park development. There may be some areas based on the type of grant that the Conservation Fund applies for. There may be some restrictions associated with it, but I'm thinking that other than outside of building inside the floodplain, I can't think of anything that will restrict us from building the type of amenities that the community would want.
Okay, but no, because this is being passed through the, whatever the name of it is, Conservation Fund, they're not going to put restrictions on it?
No. It's, from my understanding, they're not placing any restrictions on us. It will become parkland. But the only restrictions that could be placed on, that could be a part of that transfer, would be due to what type of grant they do apply for.
For their portion?
For their portion.
Okay. Theirs I don't worry about. It's in a floodplain. It's the others. I like the idea. I'm going to support it if we get a motion. I did have two issues with it. One, I didn't know what it looked like till I got to the third page, and it was not what I was expecting. Most golf courses kind of go back and forth. They're somewhat compact. This one winds its way. You can obviously tell it was a golf course. Winds its way through the neighborhoods, and I think it will be challenging to come up with a good use for that land, so I think we need to be sure we get good folks working on it. And I have questions like, is there a place you could put softball fields and things of that sort? Because basically what you've got are fairways and roughs for most of this.
I don't know if it would lend itself for softball or baseball. There are some areas that could be opened up for, I guess, multi-recreational use or just open play. Initially, looking at the property, there's some areas that will be easily developable for more active recreation near the pool, near the existing clubhouse. There are some areas that would lend itself to much more passive recreation opportunities, like especially when you get close to some of the residences that are there.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's a large enough area that's flat enough that would be for those type of bonds.
Also, do you know what condition the pool was in?
The pool itself is actually one of the better facilities on the site. It's probably one of the ones that we would recommend keeping.
Okay.
The pool house itself is in really, really good shape. There aren't any leaks that we were able to identify with the pool. The pool is filled through well water. It would require us just shocking it and getting the pumps and motors running, but the pool itself is in really, really good condition.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Going to get a motion.
I move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Do you have any other comments, Ms. Adams?
Yes. Again, I want to thank staff and everyone that worked to make this happen. Again, as Councilmember Bessie said, we expanded our city limits and we annexed some folks. And those folks have been patient over the years, but, you know, I don't blame them. They had an opportunity now to require and request some attention. They had no idea that the life that they had out there with their golf course and everything, even though they didn't own it, they built around it. And they liked that fact. And we do know that most properties built on golf courses, the cost, the value of those properties, those homes, they go up. The one thing that mostly they were concerned about at a neighborhood meeting we had last fall, which again, I said, was one of the largest I've ever had since I've been on the council. It was standing room only at the Old Town Recreation Center. They just didn't want it to be that people came in and built houses and just lots of houses, whatever the ordinance or whatever that would allow them to do that. They didn't want that. They made the request immediately, and there was almost 100% consensus. They wanted to see the land revert to some type of green space or something. I too, like some of us on the council and others, I appreciate green space. And I think anytime a city in this day and age has an opportunity to save green space and turn it into park, it's a good thing for the value of our city that we also live by that we believe in that quality of life. I'm looking forward to the area plan that we come up with, the engagement and feedback from the community and their involvement. I believe this, again, was a great investment that we did, and I think that we're all going to be proud of this at the end of the day, and I think those 6,000-plus people on the north side of town that do not have a park and they don't have a public swimming pool, or public walking paths and greenways, they don't have any of that, that this will help put a shot in the arm that we care about them just as much as we care about all of Winston-Salem as well. So,
thank you. We have a motion and a second on the floor. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise? And one abstaining. So we have three in favor, none opposed, one abstaining. And if staff could bring back to the meeting for Monday night, this Burke's question, kind of what we, and I have seen this data year, many, many years ago, kind of what are the park facilities in each ward. Yeah, it's been a long time. Okay, thank y'all very much. That was G1. We'll now go to G2.
Item G2, resolution requesting final payment be made to Charles B. Louder for the 28th Street Drainage Improvement and Water and Sewer Rehabilitation Project.
Mr. Raleigh, you're back up.
Yes, I am.
Tell
Chairman
us what
Clark,
we need to know.
Sure. Chairman Clark, Mayor Joins, members of the committee, this item requests approval for final payment to be made to Charles D. Louder Incorporated for the 28th Street Drainage Improvements and Water and Sewer Rehab Project. The project was awarded to Charles Louder on December 15, 2014 for the contracted amount of $6.39 million. The contractor at the time agreed to subcontract 5% of the work with certified MBE firms and 5% of the work with certified WBE firms. And at the conclusion of construction and at the submission of the final pay affidavit, it was determined that the contractor had failed to achieve those goals, obtaining 2.4% MWBE participation and 17% WBE participation. Mm-hmm. This item was referred to the MWBE Citizens Advisory Committee to be reviewed for a good faith effort. That review took place at its March meeting. at which time the committee determined that the good faith effort had not been made on the part of the contractor to reach or meet the previously agreed upon or the contractually agreed upon MWBE goals. And we are recommending that final payment be released. We do not have the ability to withhold final payment for the work that's been performed. But I will note on this particular project, a representative from Charles D. Louder Incorporated did appear at the MWBE Citizens Advisory Committee meeting and indicated that they recognized that they failed to meet the goals on this project but had taken corrective action to make up for this failure on a current project that they're working on. The particular MWBE that they did not reach their contractually sort of obligated spend levels with has been contracted to do work on a project now to kind of make up for that failure. So with that, I'll pause and respond to any questions.
Are there any questions, Mr. McIntosh?
So in our contract, there's a clear understanding, or apparently there should be a clear understanding, maybe not this time, about what the goals are, but there's not a clear statement of what the resolution is if they fail to meet them.
That's correct.
I understand it from the city attorney. We're not allowed by statute to withhold it, correct?
We're not allowed to withhold the payment, but the contract ordinance does provide that failure to meet those goals can, going forward, result in they're not being able to bid on future projects.
But we can take them off the bid list going forward, but we can't withhold the payment.
But we can't contractually say at this percentage you receive, at full percentage you receive 100%.
That's what she said.
Yeah.
Level okay. Below there, you're at 98%. We're not allowed to do that.
Yeah, I haven't found any provision in the law that allows
okay.
Okay,
Ms. Burke?
Yes, I was going to ask your attorney, was there anything else we can do for the future? Because if you allow a company to have that flimsy excuse that some of them want to give us, they will continue to play with you. Now, if we're in a business, then they're going to treat us like we are a business. So I would like you to do as much research as you can do to make sure that someone doesn't come to us and say, well, I'm going to do it better the next time. I'm going to make up. They cannot make up. They just need to do it right.
Okay. Ms. Adams, you had your
comment. Yes, and I guess this has something to do with the other two council members as well, and city attorney and staff. Again, when it comes to systems, again, accountable process systems, what do we have in place to ensure that they are compliant before the job is completed? Again, I know you've heard me say this for many, many years. Everybody, we want to give the benefit of doubt of doing what they promised to do for us and the citizens. But what systems are in place for us to audit for compliance that we actually go talk? If you tell me that Councilmember Clark is doing the streets. We know you're not, but
no,
anyway.
No, yeah.
But there is someone that's going to actively go talk to Councilmember Clark to actually ask him, well, are you doing the streets and have you met any blah, blah? Are you fulfilling? Are you getting the resources you need? That person then will tell us what we need to know. But if we're just going by and if we say, we don't have the time, this is going to continue to happen because I'm not saying that the contractor figured out a way to get around it, but it opens up a door.
Yeah, you talked to the contractor as well as the subcontractor.
Correct.
Sure, and I can speak to that. And to Councilmember Burke's earlier point, we are looking at and working with the city attorney's office on future projects. Fortunately, we don't have terribly many instances where this happens. But implementing some sort of formal progressive disciplinary policy, for instance, is where a contractor fails to meet the goals. But in terms of tracking of projects, typically the process is for all projects for which MWBE goals have been established, for each payment request, there's an affidavit F that's submitted by the contractor, which flows through our office, which provides information related to
the amount that MWBEs had been paid. At the final affidavit, or the final request for payment, typically our office will contact the MWBEs, review the payment applications to make sure that that the dollars have in fact been provided to the MWBEs, and typically that's when we find potentially issues and can address them then, prior to final payment being released.
But wouldn't it seem to me, what makes more sense for us to be more proactive a little bit earlier in the process than to wait until a final payment or whatever's been made, and then we figure this out? I mean, I would think that's what I would do, even if we only did it, again, in a test prototype type situation, that we test it to see if it somehow works, because I just believe this is something we can fix that will become transparent, okay?
Okay. Mr. Montgomery had his hand up next when I get there.
Yeah, one, I think in looking at it, the excuse is not a good excuse in my book. You think about the original percentage of 5% to be used, that's $319,985,000. They did 2.4%, which is $153,000, meaning that there was $166,393,000 to be expended with a minority-owned business, and to many of the smaller businesses, that's a lot of money. And so I think it's important that we're very clear in the process, and no matter if it's just one time that this happens or if it's 10 times that this happens, that it's not an accepted process. The folks, Charles D. Louder, how long have they been in business? What are other projects we've done with them?
They did provide a list. I can tell you, I can't recall, but I know that there are projects dating back at least to 2008 and have done several projects.
And the reason I say that is that particularly with organizations that have been in business for a while and bid on government contracts that have these type of requirements, there are processes in place that they know how to follow these things. And so it leads me to be less likely to believe that it just didn't work that way, because oftentimes what we see is that folks figure out, well, in the midst of the process, I can get it cheaper by doing or going with another person, so they swap out certain things, and then in this instance end up hoping that by the end of this it's a wash, and they end up saving and they expand their administrative fees and costs on what they're able to get, and they keep certain dollars in certain ways. And so I think it's important we're very clear, that $166,000 spent with a minority business would turn over a lot more than it does with some of the other businesses.
Okay, Ms. Burke, you hit
that. I was going to say that we can go back and research the minutes, and some of the same comments that you heard has been stated. I've said to the city manager, until we let individuals know that we are serious about the taxpayers' dollars and that we look at the jobs that they do and make sure they do them well, I don't feel that we have enough monitoring, going back, looking at the jobs when the jobs are completed. We just sign off and give the people checks, and we're going to have to stop doing that, because they will continue to do what they want to do.
Okay. Mr. Bessie, did you have your hand up?
Yes, I remember this problem coming up in the conversation I had with Mr. Turner about some other projects, and he had given me a more detailed explanation of what the contract told him.
On this one?
On this one.
Okay.
I don't, Mr. Chairman. I mean, Mr. Bessie, but we'll be happy to get your written report on it.
Okay.
What I recall is,
It might have been me. I can tell you I was in the meeting with the MW Advisory Committee where the superintendent came in, and he just said basically he blew it. And his foreman didn't tell him, and so he bought the pipe, stopped buying pipe. Clay pipe from the minority contractor, who's actually out of South Carolina, went to a different one, and just said he blew it. He said he dropped the ball, and he said he was going to try to make it up on the next project, which I think they're working in Ardmore. I think is where they are actually.
Isn't that right?
Yes.
So, yeah.
What?
So, they're also the same contractor who did. Well, this is 28th Street. Well, we had some other customer service issues, as the Mayor Pro Tem knows, with this contractor.
Okay, Mr. Mayor had a comment.
Yeah, Angela, I just recall in our MWB program in years past, we actually withheld payment at the end. Is that just changing the statute, you think? Or,
Probably so, but I checked
discussions at the MWE Advisory Committee years ago when I was on the other side. It was very painful to do that. But I'm agreeing with Councilman Burke. You've got to have some teeth here so folks know that they do this. You're going to get taken off the bid list for 6 months. Mm-hmm. And they're going to get taken off for 2 years.
Time out, yeah.
You can actually be taken off for 3 years.
3 years?
Yeah. Okay, Ms. Bessie, you had your hand up again.
Basically, what I thought I recalled here was that what they told them was that they got behind in the work because of weather.
Who's they got behind? The contractor.
Wow. Okay. And then when they got working again, their subcontractor said, well, I guess I don't have the pipe right now.
At one point they claimed that, but we called the subcontractor who did not, said that wasn't true. Now they did. It was a difficult project. There was weather. This was also where we had the hazardous materials in the ground, and we had to stop the project during the fair for road construction. But that's still, we have a process, and Mr. Raleigh can talk about, where all they had to do was call us, come in, fill out the form. We'd help them try to find another contractor. They didn't do any of that.
Okay. Mr. Larson,
I think there's a couple of things here. One is the process and catching the problem earlier, and we've discussed that pretty heavily. The MWBE Advisory Committee is an advisory committee, and I noticed in the proposition here that we're going to vote on, it very specifically says, whereas city staff plans to implement progressive disciplinary consequences up to and including disqualification from bidding and further contracting contracts, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not sure that an advisory committee has the authority to implement policy that's not reviewed by this council. I think we all agree that it's time to have some teeth in the process, both on the front end and in the sense of policy of how we inspect these projects. If we're going to implement some punitive policy as a result of noncompliance, I think we ought to have that brought back to us for review.
Okay. Mr. Montgomery.
And again, it goes back kind of to the punitive piece, because I wonder, I don't know who the subcontractor was who was being used for the sourcing and cost, because I just wonder what impact not having that spend on an original contract had on the other subcontract. Did they have to do anything to provide that? Just wondered what negative impact was on the one in terms of certain product to be purchased from them. Was there a negative impact with the fact that they weren't utilized for the service?
I imagine that, you know, it wasn't pleasing to the subcontractor who had a contract at the outset of the project, and at some point that obligation was not fulfilled. But speaking, you know, I can't speak specifically for the contractor. We can certainly get that in.
I just wonder if someone tells me I'm going to get a contract and I have to, well, I go out and hire 6 extra people to provide the contract, but then I don't get the full contract, there's something that I eat for that. Because I was just wondering, was that potential negative?
Two things. One, and I'm not defending this contractor at all, they are using the same subcontractor for the additional project. They're buying not just sewer, but also water pipes, and so they are ahead of the goals, as I understand it, for the next project. I think they're trying to make that up. But I just want to point back, this council doesn't have to wait for the NW Advisory Committee to give you a proposal. If you want to take, I recommend taking this, if you want to take the Louder company off the bid list for a year, I believe you can do that now if you'd like to.
But and for me, even if this, beyond what the council does, this punitive, I think it morally is right for the contractor to do whatever they do, and they likely don't just take bids and City of Winston-Salem does work otherwise. And so in order for them to probably maintain good relationship with this other subcontractor, which they probably use for other projects, they're doing that in order to make sure that they still have a good subcontractor when they move along to other projects. So I hope that they do come through with whatever they've said they're doing.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I didn't want to take this route. We did everything we could with the citizens. We had our meetings, and Mr. Turner and staff came out. And this company pledged, told me we're going to do a good job. Isn't that right, Mr. Turner?
Yes, ma'am.
And I want to tell you, they have been most disrespectful. In fact, they have not shown any respect for the people who live in the area. They had, would do what they would do, leave all of the rocks and everything in front of churches and houses, and some of the older neighborhoods and some of the older citizens had trouble trying to get into their homes. This has not been a good company. And of course, they are blamers on what the subcontractor did not do, but it's their responsibility when they have the job to make sure the people they hire will do the job. So I would hope that we could take them off the list.
Let me kind of sum up what I think, because we're asking questions beyond the immediate motion here. One, I think we should direct staff to come back with a policy, and I think it's important to have the policy before you have the punishment, so people understand the rules. And that policy would be that folks that do not adhere to certain guidelines and do not make the good faith effort. There's a difference between not making a goal and not doing a good faith effort, in my opinion. So that's number one. Number two, I would like a written analysis of exactly what happened. Now, I will say, I do purchase a lot, and everybody's got it in stock till you call them, and we didn't really mean it was in stock. We can get it for you. So I would like to know the details and also who they bought the pipe from, because I noticed their female participation was three times more than what they said. So I don't know if they bought it. I'm just curious who supplied the pipe, and was there any difference in if they'll provide a difference in cost on it. And having said that, I have never bought a pipe in my life. I don't know much about that industry. Yeah, it'd be nice, but I think these are beyond the scope of here. From what I'm hearing, we either can approve this or not, but we can't affect. It's either yes or no. We can't affect the outcome. And if they've done the work, I'm not sure how we can withhold the payment. But Mr. Larson?
Yeah, there's really two things. Are we going to pay it? Are we going to set policy either on the front end or on the back end as far as punishment or monitoring? And, you know, the way this document's written right now that we have in front of us, if that's what's going to come to us on Monday, it says the policy has been set by the committee, and I have a problem with that.
Well, I think if we're going to rewrite the motion
in order to separate the payment and the policy.
Well, I've just directed staff. We're going to direct staff to come up with a policy.
Okay.
So we will vote on the policy now. We won't do it Monday night, I don't think. I think we'll do it next month or whenever. So that's policy, a little more written analysis on what happened. And I would say I'll put number three, maybe get staff's opinion if you think the gentleman, if he's making a good faith effort. By the way, I do not know Mr. Charles Louder. If he's making a good faith effort to make up, if he is ahead in another project, that would be good to know. And if staff feels like he's worth keeping on the bid list.
I'd like to see some of that information before I vote on it. Can we pass this forward without to full council?
How quickly can all that be gotten?
Well, I was going to share, Chairman, that it is staff's intent. We've been working on a comprehensive rewrite of the program, the MWBE program guidelines that is planned to be presented to the advisory committee this month and then on to council next month, which would include these progressive discipline provisions. So ultimately, we brought back to council all of the pieces of the MWB program to be reviewed. But in terms of release of final payment.
What percent is it of the job is the final payment?
That I couldn't tell you now. I don't know. A retainage?
10%? What's anybody know? The reason I mention that, most contractors' policies with their subs is they get paid when the GC gets paid. So you're also punishing all the subs. If we don't, and if it one, put on the list, I'd like to know what percent it is. Go ahead.
What are our legal obligations if we don't pay this? Will we get sued for the balance?
Mr. Montgomery.
Here's a question just for the committee in terms of in light of the fact that the staff plans to bring forward at next month's meeting guidelines with penalties associated with that. Would it in fact make sense to hold in committee till next month and pass a resolution that both pays them and gives a penalty if that is desired to be done at the same time? It's not saying that we ain't gonna pay them, but does it have to be done in this meeting at this time, and what is the repercussions of not doing it?
Ms. Attorney, do you know, can you comment on that?
Well, I certainly would say in terms of taking them off the bidders list, I mean, that is a remedy that is available, has been available, it's in the code now, but in terms of other remedies that staff may come up with, it may be a little difficult to impose those remedies on the contract.
But Mr. Chairman, yes, I think what Mr. Montgomery said was this. Can we hold this in committee?
I think you can.
Yeah.
That would not have anything to do with this.
It would be nice to know when the money is due, how late we will be. Because I will say this. I am a small business owner, and nothing upsets me more than when big companies, and I deal with big companies, withhold payment. And that's exactly what we're doing here. We're the big dog in the room, and who you're hurting are the little subs that are not going to get paid until we pay the general. So just understand who you're hurting.
I deal with the federal government.
Oh, well, and you know how late they are. Federal government.
That's a different
story. I got a job one time. I was paid 11 months after. I got one with a Fortune 50 company. We're going to be paid almost a year later for the retainage. So, I mean, big companies have the power to do it, but that doesn't make it right. And I am a firm believer, if you bought something and you ate the hamburger, you owe the money. Now, you may not like the restaurant. You're not going to go back again. But it is wrong for big companies to knuckle under the little guy because we can.
Go ahead.
Yeah. The thing is, Councilmember Clark was saying, City Attorney Carmen, and I'm sure you will, we have to adhere to our payment policies that we have. We need to make sure we check that. Again, they rendered us service. We didn't do anything, as we said, on the front end, in the middle. We waited to the end after the fact when the job was complete. And again, that goes back to us monitoring job work, scope of work, and that's our fault. So I may not agree with what this guy did in his company, but we represent the city of Winston-Salem, our brand. This is not us. And if we owe this person for their work, based on our policies, we need to pay this gentleman his money if the work has already been done.
Let me ask the four committee. Yes, ma'am.
I believe that you pay people, but I want to tell you, you say we didn't monitor. Maybe we didn't write it up. But the city manager, he was out moving stuff so people could. We could go back and pull the minutes to show how many times we were up to fight. We listened to the complaint of the citizens. And even in just riding through, we saw them not doing their job. Well, maybe that's when we should have been writing all of this up, because it's a good background on the behavior of that company not being respected.
Okay. So let me remind everybody, I've asked the staff to come back with a policy. It sounds like you're going to incorporate that in a overall review of the MB, letter, whatever letters they are, MBE goals. We're asking for a written analysis of this. Is there a motion? There's four people on the committee. Is there a motion from anybody here that you want to do?
I would like to forward it to the council. I mean, without a recommendation.
Or to the committee next week without recommendation.
Yeah, correct.
Understanding that some of these questions may not be answered, particularly the policy, if you've got to redo the whole policy. I'll second that motion. Now they're in the comments.
And with that, we're going to get some information on how they're doing on their current ones.
That's right.
What sort of remedies they've actually done.
And, yeah. And that information we get short term. I'm certainly not going to ask staff to work all Easter weekend on
Right.
And we'll also get when the payment is due.
Yeah, I got that down. When is the payment actually due? Yes, sir, Mr. Montgomery.
And the reason I was asking about holding in committee was in reference to penalty, that I did not hear anything from this committee in reference to the fact of failure to meet the actual percentage goal. And even if the ball was dropping, as the city manager stated, that they just state they dropped the ball. And if we're going to say that we want to be very clear to those who to abide by the guidelines, then simply paying without any penalty, I think, is something that to be considered. And I know that the city attorney stated that there is something there, but I don't hear anything from this committee in terms of suggesting anything. And so for me to come forward, I'm only one person, but that's the additional conversation that I think should go along with an action that goes forward.
Let me ask, put one more thing for the staff. Let's ask for the staff's recommendation if we should suspend this gentleman's, I say gentleman, I don't know if Mr. Louder is still alive. This company should be suspended for a period of time due to this and other issues. Yes, from the bidder list. And that's a specific, not a policy issue, that's just a question just on this company. Mr.
It sounds like what Captain Burke indicated that there's a John Formick's
yes.
question.
Yeah. All right. We have a motion to send this forward without a recommendation. We also have on the, it's not part of the motion, but it's part of the discussions, the staff is going to work on a general review of the policy in this area. We're going to get a written analysis of what happened here and what they're doing with other jobs to correct it. And three, we've asked for staff's recommendation on any actions we should take specific to C.D. Louder. And lastly, for the Monday night, we would like to know what percent this is of the job and are there any, and when it's actually due and any late fees or whatever that we may incur. All right, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise, that is approved. And I will say this, I thank everyone, not just the committee members, but the other folks. I thought we had a good discussion and some good ideas came out of that. All right, we will now go to, by the way, let me just mention to the folks, the pages aren't, well, they got draft in the top of all of them. But usually I thought we put the item. Anyway, we're on G3.
It's changed.
It's changed.
All part of the, and next month it'll all be on the iPad. Yeah.
All right. You think it's bad this month? All right.
It means you need to study.
All right. Yeah. Well, the city secretary reads G3.
Item G3, resolution authorizing permanent financing for a 96-unit family rental development known as the Enclave, property located in the north.
Mr. Brooks, why don't you give us a synopsis of this?
Very good. Good afternoon, Mayor. Mayor Pro Tem, Chairman Clark, members of the committee.
Good afternoon.
This particular item is authorization of a permanent financing commitment of $400,000 and up to $500,000 for development of a 96-unit rental housing project to be known as Enclave 2. The North Carolina Housing Finance Housing Foundation, which is located here in Winston-Salem, and the Miller Valentine Affordable Housing Group. They're located in Cincinnati, Ohio. They are applying for North Carolina Housing Finance Agency Low Income Housing Tax Credit and other NCHFA assistance to construct the 96 units of housing at Bethania Station Road. The developers are requesting gap financing from the city to ensure feasibility of the project. And as we all know, when they are submitting an application for financing, they must include a letter of binding commitment from the local government and its full application, which is due May the 12th. We understand that there are three applications being submitted from Forsyth County, and NCHFA may approve none, or they could approve all three. This particular development will consist of 18 one-bedroom units, 42 two-bedroom, and 36 three-bedroom units, ranging in size from 730 square feet for one-bedroom and 908 for two-bedroom, and 1,108 for three-bedroom units. And the amenities include dishwasher, garbage disposal, washer, dryer, hookup, walk-in closet, and balcony. They will have a community room, a community center, covered picnic area, laundry room, exercise room, playground, and tot lot. A total of 24 units will be affordable to households earning up to 30% of area median income, with total housing expense, including rent and basic utilities, ranging from $329 to $456 per month. And for a family of four, the maximum income would be $17,550. For one person, that would be $12,300. A total of 72 units will be affordable to households earning up to 60% AMI, with total housing expense ranging from $658 to $912. And for 60%, up to 60%, for a household of four, that would be $35,100. And for one person, $17,500. The North Carolina Housing Foundation has over 30 years of experience with development of rental housing for elderly, special needs population. Miller Valentine, through their Miller Valentine group, has over 20 years of experience with tax credit development. We've checked their references from state and local government agencies providing funding and believe that it's all satisfactory. As background, in September of 2010, the city and Forsyth County jointly loaned just about $1.4 million in neighborhood stabilization funds to the developers to purchase 25-acre parcel of land with three structures containing 12 housing units that were already constructed on it. The original owner had planned market-rate condominiums, but the project fell through during the housing crisis and recession. NSP was designed to provide assistance to acquire and redevelop foreclosed properties that might otherwise become sources of abandonment and blight. The developers carved out approximately 8 acres of the 25-acre parcel and constructed the enclave at Winston-Salem, which is currently there. And it has 68 units of affordable rental housing for families, and now they plan to carve out an additional 7.5 acres for Enclave 2. And currently, Enclave 1 has a 96% occupancy rate as of this March. The proposed financing for the development consists of a conventional bank first mortgage loan, city funds as a subordinate mortgage, NSP funds, Forsyth County Housing and Community Development are requesting from the State Division of Community Assistance State Workforce Housing Loan Program, a deferred loan, and funds derived from the tax credits. The NSP funds are derived from program income DCA has received from the grants it made to local governments in the late 2000s, and the funds can only be used for NSP eligible activities, foreclosed upon property, NSP foreclosed upon property. And we have the preliminary sources of funding as outlined: $8.7 million federal tax credit equity, $2.6 million first mortgage bank loan, $400,000 which would be requested from the city, $800,000 NSP which would be state funds via the county, $250,000 WHLP funds, and $345,000 would be deferred developer fee. As city funds are provided as gap financing, the final rate will be determined by backing into the project once we know the requirements of the NCHFA and first mortgage loan. But it is anticipated that our loan will be an amortizing loan for a minimum loan period of 15 years with the term to start after construction complete. Proposed fund sources would come from the home funds and are locally derived funds. The proposed loan amount is $400,000. However, the resolution we are seeking authorizes up to $500,000 if NSP funds are less than what is projected. So that's the difference between the $400,000 and $500,000.
So we've got all these, a lot of moving parts here. There's no guarantee they're going to get all this, right? We're just now hoping.
No guarantee, and all of it is contingent upon the award of the 2017 application.
Gotcha. All right. And this is in the North Ward, I believe. All right. Any questions from anybody? And we have other instances where we participate and don't know till later on. Matter of fact, I think we had, we did two different participations. I don't think we got either one that time. I don't remember, but, and we'll know later. Miss Adams, is your ward?
Yes. The first project I did when I got elected was the Enclave. recession, it hit hard. That was definitely a blighted area off of Bethany Road. The structures that had been left behind had become deteriorated. The roofs, the guttering, the balconies were falling in. And they had all these concrete slabs out there that were supposed to be more structures. But the owner developers, they closed it, foreclosure, and it was just left there. Weeds were growing up. Kids, people were going in, doing things in the three structures that were there. Police were having to go. It was a bad situation. And the Miller Group met with me along with the North Carolina Housing Finance folks, and they took me on a tour of what was there. And they told me then they wanted to build affordable housing. And my only thing to them was, and they remember, as I said, it had to look like something I wanted to live in when it was finished. It had to be very appearance conscious for the community and the people that lived on the other side of the woods behind the 25 acres. The community was involved in this. All I can tell you now is I've been up there for several meetings, community events, and they're right. It stays full, and there's a waiting list most of the time to get in the enclave. It's very kept very nice, good quality of life, housing stock. They got great community partners that come in there and support and assist with resources to the residents that live there. Again, this is one of our, to me, goes in the books as one of our best affordable housing partnerships we've done since I've been on the council. So I'm hoping that everyone will support this. I think it's great. I move that we move to accept this proposal, this resolution.
We have a motion, second. Any comments, Mr. McIntosh?
Yes, not necessarily about this project, but just sort of structurally here and from a process standpoint. These are home funds. We're assuming these home funds are going to be available from the federal government. Is there any doubt that those are going to be out there? I mean, I know we won't cut our check until those funds come from them. So we're not at risk there, but right. I mean, is there any thought process to those being at risk? Our loan, will that money will come back to us, right?
And yes, go. Will not go into the fund last.
And per Mr. Montgomery's typical questions, so that will go back into a fund that will be reused for housing, yeah. Not into a general fund, right? How deep a dive do we do on this? I mean, we're in second position. I guess the federal tax credit equity comes in not as a loan. That's just sunk money. First mortgage bank loan will be in first position, and it will be in second position should something go wrong. And I'm assuming this is a fairly typical capital stack that we see. How much due diligence do we do in these projects, or do we place an awful lot of faith in the fact that the feds have looked at it and blessed it, and we know that this particular developer has done a good job? I mean, how much actual time and effort do we spend on it? Because, I mean, we're on the hook for, we're playing the bank for $500,000 on this.
We have very close monitoring, both on the front end and during construction and on the back end. Also, we have our partners coming from the county, I think.
Yeah.
Dan is here from the county. We had Mr. Tulis, I thought I heard Dan, Mr. Tulis from Miller Valentine, and some representatives from the Housing Foundation. I just wanted to recognize them. But with respect to your question, we monitor these projects fairly closely.
So we get a pro forma, we go crunch the numbers.
Oh, absolutely.
We do all that.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. We have motion. Mr. Larson, did you have your hand up?
I do have some.
You go right ahead.
Quick questions. According to the write-out, it says that they've already received 5 applications and they can only accept 3. So is this number 6? This report says the NCHFA may fund 0 to 3 proposals from Forsyth County. It received 5 pre-applications from Forsyth County.
From my understanding, the 5 would include the 1.
So we have a 1 and we have 3 and 5.
We have a 60% chance.
We have a 60% chance. The original amount that bought 25 acres was basically $1.4 million. Has that been paid back, or is that being paid back down? Where is that money being recovered at this point? I mean, it looks like, you know, they built on 8 acres, and now they're going to build on 7.5, so that's 16.
You can get that information later for you.
Yeah, the project closed several not several, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, and they've started paying back on the loan, yes.
So what I'm at, what I'm looking for is collateral here, which just sort of follows up on the question of being second in line in the mortgage and everything else. You know, we've got some money already invested in it. It's a great project. I mean, I'm all for
I know.
It. I'm trying to figure out the, where the money is here, you know, and also what the collateral is. It looks like we've got about 9 acres still sitting out there, which means we may see a phase three. If it doesn't happen this time, because it doesn't make the five cut, is this time sensitive? We'll see it again next year. Is that?
I would imagine it's likely to happen. Is that?
You will come up, sir. You can get on TV.
My name is John Nichols, and I represent the North Carolina Housing Foundation.
Can you give an address for us, how we would reach you?
It's 750 Bethesda Road,
okay.
Salem.
Thank you.
It's in some of the
okay, places. Thank you.
But what I was going to mention is that the number of pre-applications, the process is, pre-applications go in January, and then a final application will go in May. And there's several things that hinge on whether there'll be a final application in May. One of them would be City Council approving the funding for the up to $500,000. So the pre-apps that are out there, kind of to address your question, all of them may not apply for a final app, so there may or may not be that much competition when the final app.
So it's only from the city, a municipality, or the county could submit. They have to. So we haven't seen another one from the city.
This is. Can private people submit them?
Private developers, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, you can go on North Carolina Housing Finance Agency's website and you can look at the called QPA for the tax credit program, and there'll be a whole list of everybody in the state that's applied under the pre-application. And this, so you know that the site score is usually what you're looking for in the pre-application, and this site did receive a perfect site score.
Great.
So, you know, odds are really good that if all the other pieces come together, then we'll get the funding. But the city and the county do own a deed of trust for that original NSP money, so it'll give you an opportunity to, you know, use this additional land to provide affordable housing. And if we are fortunate enough to be able to get the projected $800,000 in the additional NSP money, then that would be that much money that the city and county can bring into the area for affordable housing that you don't have now. That's a real positive piece of it.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Mayor?
Yeah, just real quick, did you get all your questions?
Yes, I got
okay. Just to comment on Councilmember Larson's point about collateral, which is a good question. If you think about the equity coming into this, we're in a 35% loan to value position, so that's
And I do remember, Ms. Adams reminded us, but I do remember this up there, and it was just kind of, the grass was growing and the weeds were growing, we've done very well up there. Did we get a motion?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I've been so long, I've forgotten. We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. And I'd appreciate staff just kind of keeping us posted on this one. Be nice.
Thank you. We will.
Thank you. We have two more items left. Mr. Rao, how long is it going to take you?
Presentation on the compensation study.
I know that, but how long do you need? Your last. Yeah.
Really, that's more of an open discussion. If the committee has any
questions,
like maybe the action item.
All right, and then how long is the? All right, you got 15.
That's all.
You're up. Number four is a presentation on the compensation study.
Today we've got with us the consultant who did the compensation study. It's the company is Springstead. She's the vice president with Springstead. Her name is Ann Antonson. She's going to talk about the study itself, and after she's done, I'm going to just give you a little brief information that's in a handout that you have at your place. So that's the handout you're looking at now is mine. And
she's going to do her thing on the screen.
Yes.
All right. If you'll give your name and address for the record, please.
Hi, good evening, Chairman, members of the committee. My name is Ann Antonson with Springstead, and our address is 380 Jackson Street, St. Paul, Minnesota.
Thank you. Welcome to the sunny South. Mm.
Thank you. It was sunny in Minnesota yesterday, but not so much today.
Well, I've been there in the winter.
So, well, good evening. As Carmen said, we conducted a classification and compensation study for the city of Winston-Salem, and this was the first of kind of a phased-in process. So we did one-third of city positions as a part of this study. And the goal of this was to review and evaluate the current classification and compensation program, which included developing new classification descriptions for the positions that were covered under this part of the study. Goal was to determine what is the current relationship of the wages that are provided to those employees and the benefits that are provided to those employees in comparison to the area labor market. So doing that comprehensive review. Then looking at how positions compare to one another within the city of Winston-Salem. So looking at the market, and then that internal comparison is to ensure that positions within the city that are similar in nature, so they have similar levels of essential job functions that they're performing, similar levels of job responsibilities and job requirements, that those positions are compensated at a level that's consistent with one another within the organization. And then taking that information and developing a compensation plan that provides for internal equity amongst all the positions covered under the study and is competitive out in the area labor market. And then looking at, as a part of that review, identifying, you know, the relevant compensation factors that accurately reflect the value of different types of work. So looking at how you compare very different types of work to one another within the same organization. And then the last piece would be establishing policies and guidelines for maintaining and administering the study recommendations moving forward, and then preparing a plan to implement those study recommendations. And that's what we're bringing to you this evening. So just briefly, I know we're on a tight timeline, but just briefly an overview of the process that we used to get to where we are today. We had initial meetings with the city manager, with human resources, with the management team, and with department heads. And with department heads, we had both group meetings and individual meetings so that we could become familiar with each department's functions, their positions, the services that they're providing, the staff that were going to be covered under the study, and any issues or concerns that they had that they would like to see addressed throughout this study, such as recruitment, retention, high levels of turnover, those types of issues. We also had multiple employee meetings at many sites across the city to ensure that the majority of employees that were covered by the study had the opportunity to attend a meeting, find out information about the study, how they could participate in the study, and ask any questions that they might have regarding the study. Then the next phase was starting the collection of data. And the first piece of that was getting employee and supervisor information and participation. We asked employees in every position included in the study to complete a position analysis questionnaire, and that questionnaire gave them the opportunity to share with us what they were doing in their jobs. So what were the functions that they were performing in their positions within the city, and then what was required in order for them to be able to perform those functions. So level of education, any prior work experience, any licenses or certifications, knowledge, skills, and abilities that were required, and other factors that apply to their position to assist us in collecting the market data and to review that internal equity relationship. So we then developed classification descriptions for all those positions. We evaluated those positions based on their current job functions and responsibilities. We then use that information also to obtain our market salary and benefits information. So we took summaries from those new class descriptions and included them in the survey that was sent out in the marketplace to ensure that we were getting valid comparisons so that the survey participants could see what is the responsibilities, what are the requirements of the position in Winston-Salem, and let us know whether they had a position that was similar and what they were paying that position. We then developed a compensation plan based on the internal relationships, based on the market survey data. So we designed the structure, then we assigned positions within that compensation plan based on those results, and then developed implementation options for where individual employees then fit into the proposed pay plan. So the communities that were used as benchmarks are in front of you. So we had 14 cities and counties and towns that, and towns that were included in that market survey. And we were able to obtain information in a variety of ways from each of these different communities. Some responded directly to our survey, some sent us pay plans and benefit summaries, and some we were able to find other sources to gather their data. Went down a little too fast. So these are the 14 communities that were included in that survey. And what were our findings in the survey? We had 88 positions included in the survey, and those positions included a cross sampling of every level of position that was included in the survey and every type of work that was being performed by every position. So we had a good global review of all the positions included in the survey. We did a comparison of starting salaries to market, so where you were hiring, what was your hiring rate for employees, and how did that compare to the hiring rate into other organizations? And on average, they were about 8% below average for your starting salaries. Some were fairly close to market, some were slightly above market, and we had some positions where their starting salaries were very significantly below the marketplace and needed significant adjustment. So as a part of our review then, we also identified internal pay relationship inequities that existed. And that's pretty standard. That happens over time in every organization. You know, some positions change and it's a major change in function and the compensation level keeps up with it. But most positions, there's a little bit of scope creep. So they change very subtly over time and their compensation levels don't necessarily keep up with those changes in the position. And then when we looked at benefits, we looked at kind of a comprehensive review of your benefits as far as time off, insurance, and other types of benefits, and they were overall consistent with the market. You know, some areas might have been a little high, some a little bit low, but on average, they were fairly consistent with the market. So for the internal review, we used what's called a job evaluation system, and this is common practice in public and private sector organizations worldwide. This is the tool that assists in determining whether positions are lined up appropriately within your organization. This is especially important if the position was not included as a benchmark for the market survey or if we did not receive valid market data, so we didn't get a good comparison out in the marketplace. So the SAFE job evaluation system that we use was developed specifically for use in the public sector. It's copyrighted, it's been tested in federal court and been found to be an equitable system for evaluating the relationships of positions within an organization. All the information we used for the internal evaluation, these 9 job factors, is information that was obtained specifically from the position analysis questionnaires that were completed by employees and their supervisors and reviewed on up the chain of command. So looking at, you know, education, certifications, work experience, supervisory responsibilities, the physical demands, the working conditions. So a good overall view of all aspects of the different positions. So then we looked at pay philosophy as we developed the compensation plan. So looking at providing fair and equitable compensation to all employees within the city of Winston-Salem, balancing what's happening in the external market with the internal equity of positions across the city, maintaining a competitive pay structure that also took into consideration the city's fiscal resources for implementation, building in a performance-based component for individual employee compensation, so looking at how individuals perform in their jobs, and making sure it's an understandable compensation program for all of the stakeholders. So we have two different pay scales. This is the pay scale for all positions, excluding your law enforcement positions. So this is a scale that has 15 grades. You know, as the city moves into the other two-thirds of staff, this may expand because there will be other levels of positions included. But there are 15 grades. There is a 50% spread between the minimum and the maximum of the range, and there's a 7% spread between grades. And this is consistent with the types of compensation plans out in the benchmark communities that were included in the study. It should be noted that as a part of this plan, we have increased the minimum rate so that minimum at grade one is now $11.25 per hour. So that has increased as a part of this study. Then we have the pay scale for your police positions, and this has 10 grades. There's still a 50% spread in the grades, but there's a 5% spread between the different ranges, which is more consistent with the differentials in law enforcement positions. So you can see where the police positions covered by this study are laid out. We have the police officer trainee that's at a grade one, police officer at a two, a corporal and detective at a grade 6, and then the police sergeant at a grade 10. So then we looked at implementation. So where do individual employees fit into this? And what we have as an option for your review tonight includes moving those employees who have a current wage, which is below the minimum, and then also making adjustments for those employees that fall within the range. So of the 442 non-police positions, employees that were covered under this study, we had 287 of those who have a current wage which falls below the minimum of the grade proposed for their position. And that's consistent with our market findings showing how low your starting salaries are out in the marketplace. 731 total, 442 below minimum. Then we had 287 employees whose current wage falls within the range, so it fell within that minimum to maximum range. And then two employees who have a current wage which falls above the proposed maximum for their position. And that's not all that unusual when you do a study after time. So when we looked at, you know, employees below minimum, moving them to the minimum, making an adjustment to those employees within range of a 2% adjustment, the total cost for wages only was about $1.3 million, and then the total including benefits is $1.8 million. Then for the police employees, there are 502 of those staff. 26 of those employees have a wage which is below the proposed minimum. 459 are within range, and 17 are above the proposed range. And the total cost using the same types of implementation is 478, basically 479, excluding benefits, and including benefits, 760,000. So the total cost of implementation is 2.6 million with an impact to the general fund of about 2 million.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to know if Carmen wanted to explain the benefits piece a little bit more, but I know we're short on time. So, okay. So with that.
Okay, Ms. Adams, question asked.
Yes, Chair Clark, can we also, or may we bring this back as well during our discussion, during all of the finance committees? Can we?
Yeah, I'm going to comment on the budget in a minute.
Correct. And I wanted to know in the pay grades, is management in that 1 through 15?
No.
I would like to see a breakdown of that in that same type data because, I mean, I don't know how we do this now, and we talked about it, but I was in management, and there were labor grades for us as well. So I would also, I think showing just this, one side of the equation, council needs to see the other side of the equation as well, the full picture. You guys okay with that?
Well, I think we're going to comment.
Okay, good enough.
Or Lee, you want to comment?
The rest of the employees, this is actually counting police, they studied about half of our employees.
Right.
And we're probably going to recommend to do, instead of a third, just do the other half this coming year. And then all of management and mid-level will be putting grades. But right now we haven't studied those positions to know where they would go on the new system.
But I guess my comment to that, Mr. Garrity, is it might behoove us to go ahead. And I thought we were studying the whole staff layout, Councilmember Clark, I did.
Okay.
And I understand what we're trying to do. But I think when you do this, you're not imparting all the necessary information, and we're not getting the big picture and the critical pieces. So somehow or another, I hope, and maybe it's got to come back again as a budget item to do this, but I do believe we need to move expeditiously on our management staff as well to get a better understanding of how we pay them versus other cities as well.
Mr. McIntosh has a question.
Just a quick one, and you may have covered this and I missed it, but what's the difference? The total cost of implementation is $2.5 million, and the impact on the general fund is $1.9. Where's the delta for there?
All the rest of that is utilities employees.
Yeah.
Okay.
There are a lot of labor trades, maintenance workers, equipment operators, and the utilities fund primarily. That are.
All right. And I know it's not strictly part of this, but I'd like to see some sort of overall view on or report on what we are doing to use technology to not have to hire as many people. I think we're in 14 people this time. I mean, an algorithm doesn't have a pension. You know, what are we doing to keep from having a, I'm not advocating laying people off, but what are our efforts to augment through technology and so we don't have to have as many bodies?
Mr. Chairman, you may not be thinking about laying people off, but technology dictates.
Right.
They had a whole program on television talking about it. We have this technology, so jobs will be eliminated.
As they always have been.
Yes.
And more creative, is that creative destruction?
Correct.
We're getting close. Let me just throw, Mr. Larson, I'll come to you in a minute, throw a few things out. Ms. Garrity, you just answered my first question. While we looked at one-third of positions, we looked at 1,200 employees, which is roughly half the staff. I did know this was a multi-year plan, and you're going to do the other half this coming year, and then we'll have it all done. You also answered another question. I have gotten calls from folks on the Utilities Commission. They were particularly concerned about certain salary levels, and I think some of it was the operators.
Instrument technician.
Instrument technician.
They're all in this study.
They're all in there. Okay, so that's done. And I was a little surprised you didn't use some private sector benchmarking. I understand you used a lot of cities, but I'm not asking you to go back and redo it, but I think the question is, who do you compete with to get people? And we don't compete with the most part, when we might management level, but with the city of Wilmington, but we do compete with local folks, Greensboro, and then local folks. I do like the idea when we come to the budget time to re-include this information. And I would like to make, as I was going to make a comment on budget, I'll make it now. We did have our committee, the whole meeting last Monday, I believe it was. And I challenged both the staff and all council members, including me, to look that over and to get up with Mr. Garrity and other folks between now and when the budget is released, which will be the end of April, to express any concerns, desires, whatever your opinions may be, so Mr. Garrity can.
We'll be setting those up individually.
Yeah. Can have as much input as he can. By the time we get here to the committee level, we have so much to do. I would like everybody to try to communicate that back. Okay. Would you like to comment on your thing?
Just very quickly. We had some questions after the last presentation. I thought I would share a little bit of that with you. The first slide you've got looks at public safety, just what you've done as the council for public safety pay. And it looks over the last 5 years and then the proposal. And basically since 2014, you've been making adjustments on every year for public safety pay. And since 2016, you've been making additional supplemental pay adjustments. And it's, and you know, as we've talked about before, it's gotten us pretty up, but it hasn't quite gotten us there. We believe that the proposal this year will get us competitive with the market, but you know, that's a moving market. Mm-hmm. So just wanted to show you that one. And this is probably the last slide in your handout. I've moved it. There were questions about turnover in police and police and fire. And what you'll see is that we've had some pretty significant turnover in police. The 30 folks that we've lost, and this is voluntary turnover. It doesn't include terminations. It doesn't include retirement. And okay, you'll see in 16 we lost 30 police officers. Put that in perspective, we just started a class and we were only able to see 18. So that's 30 that we lost.
That are not being replaced with 18.
Right.
I can do that math in my head.
Yeah. And the reason
13,
for
right?
primary reason for police turnover, this shows, is 44% pay. So that tells it too, tells the story too.
Okay.
For fire, it's, we have a lot of folks that don't tell us why they leave, but changing career, which could also be related to pay. And the last one just shows how what's going on with applications. Police applications, as you see, the blue are steadily going down. And this year, for the first time in 3 years, fire applications actually were higher than police applications.
So you're telling me out of 662 applications for police, we only had how many in 2016 in the classes?
18.
Well, that's this last class. How about in 2016? The 18 was 2017 data. How many recruits did you have in the two training classes in 2016 combined?
They got hired. The ones.
So 15 would be a 2016 class. And then how about the other 2016 class? Do you remember the...
Are you talking about applications?
No, I'm talking
hired.
About... Of the number of people that applied of the 662 last year, how many of them ended up in a class? We have two classes a year, right?
Right, we have two classes. The class that graduated 15 started with 21 employees.
So we have 20 to 25 per class.
Right.
Is that close enough number? So out of 662, we maybe had 50 ended up in a class.
Right. Both those classes, we attempted to hire at least 40 individuals.
Yeah. Okay.
The requirements are stringent.
Yeah, obviously. Okay. Thank y'all very much. Ben, I'm going to move you to next month. By the way, what he was going to go over, each committee is looking at those portions of the strategic plan that apply to us, and I did look them over, but we'll go over it next month. Okay. 6:15, public safety will convene. That's in 5 minutes in the same room. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.